one or two of the previous lectures, just to remind you that they are on YouTube. The sound isn't bad, it's not perfect, but it's not bad. We're doing the best we can with the technology we've got. Benji's doing a great job. I think you should give him a round of applause for being here, actually. So he's going to live stream this session with Kelly and Miles. We're going to start in a moment. So just to remind you, I'm posting the links to these YouTube videos up in the forum section on the digital learning environment. So you can click on them there and revisit if you wish. There was a question this morning about how do you reference these. There's two ways you can do it. Either you can reference it as if it was a conversation, or a lecture as you've attended, or you can reference it as a URL like you would any other website, but using the YouTube URL instead of any other website. Remember, for quotes and for referencing of anything that's on the web, you need to show that it's online, so available online at, then the full URL, and then the retrieval date, whatever that date is that you saw it, okay? So without any further ado, I'm going to introduce Kelly Davis, who's going to talk to you about one size fits all. Thanks, Kelly. Yes, come on, welcome back. There we go.
maybe. We've just been talking about this actually. It's to give everybody a level footing, a level playing field, so no matter where you come from in the country, everybody's learning a similar thing and everybody can come out of it with a similar understanding, so that there is possibility for social mobility, there is possibility. So nobody, you know, you don't get a better education if you're more affluent. Everybody should have the same.
I really love the words you use there, possibility for social mobility. That's really nice. And that really ties in with what we were talking to you about today and kind of my perspectives. So really lovely that. Anything else? Okay, well, that's fine.
One down here, Kelly.
Okay.
Can we call it the national curriculum when the government are pushing for academies and preschools that don't have to follow the national curriculum?
Oh, that's interesting. We can call it the national curriculum because it is the national curriculum at the moment, and that's what I'm referring to. I agree with what you're saying there. We have a period of unrest or uneasiness, if you like, where things are changing, constantly changing. And throughout your teaching careers, you will have to adapt to these things and make the very best of them that you can. But I might return to that question at the end, if that's okay. But really, really lovely. Yeah. Through me. Question already. So, my next question is it possible to teach the national curriculum to all children? Some of you might be thinking, well, Kenny, you know it's not, but kind of, I want just to think about that. Are all children in mainstream state schools that are following the national curriculum at the moment, are they all able to be taught the national curriculum? And I want you to discuss this, because this really links into my own personal perspectives on education. So have a bit of a chat, and this might rile a few of you up a bit, if you've had your coffee this morning.
You could teach them it, but they might never catch up or be at the age-related expectation that is seen to be where they should be.
Yeah, lovely. Yes. Yeah.
I was just going to say, does it promote an ethos of failure if all children are expected to meet the same standard when we know that's not realistic?
And personally, I think it really does. And again, I think this all ties in with disaffection, and we're going to talk about that in a moment. Anyone else have any thing, burning desires to tell me something? Nothing's burning right now, that's good, okay. Right, so I'm going to give you a couple of examples, and sometimes I use examples like this just to kind of make a point. See here we've got two children, and actually these two children were real cases, if you like. Jack had a brilliant night's sleep. Last night he asked his mum to read him a story about the solar system. She did. Had a banana and a bowl of Cocoa Pops for breakfast. Jack's done his homework. Mum helped. Has researched all about Mars. Jeff can't wait to go to school today. He knows his teacher is going to love his drawing of Mars and all the information that he's brought together. And today he's going to be able to present his homework to the rest of the class, and he's going to be super proud. Okay. Now Katie, who's also in Jeff's class, she didn't go to bed until 1 a.m. She's feeling pretty tired. She stayed up late watching TV. She had a packet of crisps for breakfast, and because that's all she could find in the house. Katie asked her mum to help her with her homework last night, but Katie's mum told her to do it herself. It was her homework. Katie asked her mum if she knew if there was any paper. Katie's mum told her to get lost and stop bothering her. Katie couldn't find any paper. Katie couldn't do her homework. Today, Katie's going to have to stand in front of the rest of the class with nothing. Katie is going to have to make up some sort of excuse for not doing her homework. What might happen in class for Katie today? Just shout it out. What might happen?
Embarrassment,
yeah. She might feel embarrassed. What else?
Staying up late.
Sorry?
Staying up late.
She might have to stay up, so she might get punished, yeah, for something that was beyond her control. How would it make you feel if you were punished for something that you couldn't control, if you tried? Angry, pretty rubbish, annoyed with the person that's punishing you, annoyed that they hadn't asked you why that you hadn't done it, or maybe they had asked you why but you couldn't tell them. There's lots of things that could happen for Katie in that kind of scenario. And this is what I want you guys to think about. So, children who we sometimes refer to as disaffected, okay? Children can disengage from education, they can disengage from the national curriculum, they can disengage from learning together, can't they? And it's not easy to provide a kind of universal definition for this. So it's really important that you see disaffection as fluid. Now, Gutteridge talks about this. It's desirable to create a universally accepted definition, but disaffection actually changes with time, context, and I see, and I view disaffection as something that's transient, okay? So at some point in my life, I might appear to be disaffected, okay? I might not want to go into work, I might throw something at a wall, I might be really angry, I might be really cross. But that doesn't mean to say that I won't go to work the next day and do a really good job, okay? And this all feeds into labels, which we're also going to talk about. So, you could say a child that was deemed disaffected would be unable to participate in learning and or the school community on a number of levels, impacting them and or others. So usually when we talk about disaffection, it's an ongoing process, it's quite a long-term thing. It's not just kind of one bad day, okay? Now, I may have shown this to you before. Has anyone seen this before? Can you see it at all? Some of you have seen it. So this is by Skinner et al. And this looks at kind of the behavioural and emotional factors or indicators of disaffection. Okay, some of you might be quite interested in this. So for example, if a child is engaged, behaviourally, they'll be demonstrating persistence, effort, exertion in your lessons. They'll be demonstrating that they want to engage. Okay? You can usually tell if a child is behaviourally engaged in your lesson. If they are disaffected, on the other hand, they will withdraw, give up quite easily, suggest that they can't do it anyway. They may be distracted very easily and unprepared. So that's quite a common thing as well. In terms of emotional engagement, you will usually see a child being quite excited, demonstrating pride, satisfaction, enjoyment, interest. But with disaffection on the emotional side of things, boredom, disinterest, frustration, anger, sadness, worry, anxiety, shame, lots of things come into this. So, my next question is, have any of you encountered seeing any of these things, perhaps? Or can you reflect on an experience where you may have observed a child that could have been deemed disaffected? So when you've been on one of your longer placements, have you noticed this? kind of teacher said, oh, they're not going to get involved. Kind of think about this, and what behaviours demonstrated this to you, or what made you think that they were disaffected? Okay? Have a bit of a chat, 2 minutes, and then I'll come to you.
Selective mute, because we had those in classes and we had a specialist in school who was trained to sort of diagnose that, and we had all sorts of work with. She just shut off one day, and we didn't know what the trigger for this was, but she just suddenly would stop communicating with us as teachers, with staff in general, and with the pupils, and she just used to take herself into the corner. And at that point, as a teacher, there's not a lot you can do to try and get her back involved. If she's making the decision that they don't want to be involved, then there wasn't a lot we could do at that point. And that's when we had to call sort of various agencies and get sort of inter-agency support and try and find out what's going on.
Yeah, that's a really interesting example, actually, and that's quite common. It's not always the kind of throwing things, being really rude, kind of running around the classroom, hitting people and things, and telling people to do things that aren't particularly polite, which is the behaviour that you get. Sometimes you get this completely withdrawn behaviour. And any type of behaviour that isn't usual for the child is worrying, isn't it? It's concerning. And obviously something has triggered that. And you did the right thing. You got external agencies and people within your school to get involved in that. And hopefully, you know, there have been some changes put into place and that's been investigated thoroughly. But that's going to probably be a long-term process that sadly you won't necessarily know what happened because you left your placement, which is the reality of training. Any other kind of examples anyone would like to? Any low-level stuff? Yeah?
I don't know if it is disaffection, but I've seen where children sort of disengage with a particular subject. So there was a boy that was, you know, really good in maths and he thrived, but when it came to do something in English, he automatically withdrew and was like disengaged. It didn't really mean something happened at home. It could have been, you know, it could have been a teacher that said maybe give him some input before and he's using that. We didn't really know why, but he's disengaged with a subject rather than just one day. Okay. I don't know if that's relating to this.
Well, yeah, you can become disengaged with certain areas of the curriculum. Yes. I wouldn't necessarily go as far to say that child was disaffected from education. I'd just say that there's obviously some sort of issue around that particular subject. It's great that you identified it was with a particular subject, and hopefully teachers would work with that child to kind of get rid of those issues and so that he could enjoy English again. Now, in reality, when we are talking about children who may be deemed disaffected, and I really kind of hate using that word because I hate labels, okay? And I will talk about that more later. But you may see disinterest, doodling coming. So I remember teaching a lesson and one young man, I would talk to the class just briefly because I was a science teacher. People normally wanted to come to my lessons anyway because they got to do science experiments, because my main teaching experiences were secondary. And they come in and they get quite excited, but one young man would just sit there going every time I spoke, which was really interesting behaviour because you actually couldn't hear me speak over this humming. So it can be quite distracting and disruptive to the lessons. So there again, distraction techniques, laughing, and I don't mean just having a bit of fun. You're allowed to do that. You're allowed to laugh in lessons. But kind of spontaneous outbursts of laughter, deliberately trying to kind of, distract from the lesson, etc. So behaviour. Grunting, aggression, those around, so that can be at the teacher. I've had aggression aimed towards myself, and reasons are very often not fully known. Okay, they can walk into the lesson and won't know why it's happening. Verbal, physical, challenging behaviour, refusal to get involved completely. No, I won't do that. Okay, and that is, like you said at the back, that is quite tricky because behaviour issues, usually you can find some way around, but if someone's, no, I'm not going to do it. What to do? It's tricky. Refusal to get involved, as I said, tantrums, shouting, varied emotional responses, self-doubt, sadness, anger, and completely withdrawn. So you may see all of those things. Now, there are reasons for children becoming disengaged and disaffected from their learning. Family and home circumstances are a major cause, and my research talks about that later in more detail. Low-level literacy. If you can't access what everyone else in your class is doing, it makes you feel bad, it makes you not feel good, and it makes you feel that people are speaking in a different language, and you are going to act up, you are going to eventually disengage, because what's the point? You're trying, but it doesn't work. What's the point? Teaching methods can cause issues as well. Standing at the front doing stuff like this, that can cause major issues. Okay. Vulnerable children. So, certain groups are more at risk of becoming disaffected from education. And those groups could be looked after children, for example. Children from low socioeconomic backgrounds. But I really want to say now that I do not think that just because you are a looked after child or just because you come from a low socioeconomic background that you will necessarily become disaffected. That is not what I believe, okay? And all my research fights against that. So before anyone says, outrageous what Kelly said, she cannot generalise like that. That is not what I'm saying. I'm saying research and statistics points to that. So my personal view, my perspective is how do we solve that? What do we do to stop that happening? Okay, so as I said, I feel really uncomfortable with this term disaffection or disaffected child. Okay, and there are lots of reasons for that. I view disaffection as something that's transient, okay? There are periods in our lives where we can become disaffected for numerous reasons. Could be bereavement of a family member, could be a divorce, it happening in the home. It could be the fact that you started to mix with a different kind of group of children, maybe you're a teenager, and maybe they're doing some things that they shouldn't be. And you're getting involved with people that you didn't used to get involved with. You're staying up late, you're doing some naughty things, okay? Could be anything. I really hate this phrase, disaffected youth. And media does ban this kind of phrase around. Children, in my experience, only display challenging behaviour, only display periods of being disengaged from education when there is something causing it. There is something causing that. And I do believe that we are failing if we don't try and at least support them and work out what that is. I prefer to call children who may be deemed as disaffected children at high risk of exclusion. Because they are in an at-risk group throughout that period of time, and we need to work out how to reintegrate them back into education successfully. So, light bulb, my eyes. So let me move on to my research and my thinking. So, lots of you have been writing your dissertations up. Some of you may have finished, well, only some of you write in the kind of nitty-gritty of it. So this is my title for a for my PhD in life at the moment, or the most recent version, because PhDs tend to kind of change a lot. So an ethnographic case study of two alternative education centres exploring student-teacher relationships when learning outside the findings from a pilot study. Now, just quickly, I'm literally, so that you guys can link this to your own research and things, I'm literally looking at two different pupil referral units or alternative education centres. So I go and spend a lot of time in there. I've been working with these schools for 2 years now. So when I'm not here, I can be found in a forest, in a river, trying not to climb up the side of a mountain, because I really hate it, but knowing I need to do it for my research. But kind of doing those things, and doing those things with the people I want to make changes for, okay, the children that have been excluded from mainstream schooling. Okay, and that's where my passion lies. So I carry out observations, interviews, and focus groups in both schools. I've been doing this for a long period of time now. And I've got to know a lot of the students and a lot of the staff very well. So my personal context, I've got a history of working with children that display very challenging behaviour. So before I even got into teaching, I was a senior support therapist, and I worked with children in a residential secure unit, and saw some of the most extreme behaviours I've ever seen. And it was at that point I realised that everyone comes with kind of story, a background, there's a reason why people are doing the things that they do, whether they're children, whether they're adults, whatever. And it really sparked my interest, and from that point on I decided that I did want to make a difference, like lots of you in this room will have said, maybe in your interviews, and maybe in your interviews when you go into schools, I don't know. So then I decided to train as a teacher. I've had a lot of experience of what can happen to children that are labelled, because when you go into schools, not all schools are perfect, and that's the reality. You go into schools and some children may be labelled by teachers, which shouldn't be happening, but it does happen. Oh, so-and-so, don't try with them because of this or because of that. I hope it doesn't happen as much now. I hope it doesn't happen at all. But it does happen, and I've seen how negatively these labels can impact children. If you've ever heard of something called stereotype threat, anyone heard of that before? No? Okay. So generally, if you're suggesting that someone's going to be a certain way, they will live up to that. Okay. So for example, when I talked about my parents divorced, sorry for that, children from divorced families, I do not believe this by the way, will not do as well in education. You know, that would be a stereotype threat if, you know, we were bounding that around. Because actually the children might just think there's no point, I might as well live up to that rubbishy label or those expectations. Okay. First-hand experience of change that can happen when the children are learning outside. So I'm really exploring this. I've seen firsthand when I was a teacher and when I've been working in these pupil referral units, there's a real change that occurs in these children that have not been able to engage in the national curriculum in schools, but for some reason they can engage in the national curriculum if it's taught outside. So why is that happening? And I've actually had experience of being labelled as a child. As I said, my parents divorced. Lots of things kind of, I remember someone actually coming into a big assembly and someone saying, effectively, if your parents are divorced, you are going to end up committing crimes and not having a good job. And I thought to myself, oh God, well that's terrible. I don't think I've stolen anything before. Actually, I know I haven't stolen anything, but apparently I better get used to it, because that's what we can do. And those kind of things, hopefully they don't happen so much anymore, but those kind of things did happen a lot when I was growing up. I think a really important point I want to make here is, if you looked to the person next to you as well, you have no idea what experiences they had as a child, growing up, anything. You have no idea of the struggles they had to get to higher education. And they may have had a lot of struggles, we don't know. Some people choose to keep it, you know, to themselves. The children I want to help, the children I want to make changes for, are children that supposedly wouldn't be able to do that because they come from these kind of tricky, challenging family backgrounds, socioeconomic backgrounds. So my entire research, my whole direction, my philosophy has been underpinned by these experiences. Now, just a quick clarification of the keywords I'm going to use while I talk about my research. Learning outside, I'm talking about learning outside of the classroom. Okay, I'm not just talking about learning in the natural environment, although you will see my findings specifically highlight learning in the natural environment. When I talk about alternative education centres or pupil referral units, I mean a school that children attend if they've been temporarily or permanently excluded from their mainstream school. Okay? Has anyone ever been to one? A couple of people? Yeah? Good? Good? Yeah. And when I talk about high risk of exclusion, I'm talking about a child, any child, that may be at risk from being excluded from their school. Okay? And it could be anyone. It could be someone from a super rich family. It could be someone from the most perfect family, but you still don't know what's going on. Okay? So, what happens when a child is permanently excluded from school? Who knows? I haven't talked about it a bit, but what happens? That wasn't rhetorical. Does no one know? Does no one know? Okay. So what happens is the child is excluded, and they can be excluded for a fixed term, and they may be allowed to go back to their school, their mainstream school. But they may not be allowed to go back to their mainstream school. They may be permanently excluded, and the decision may be made it would be better for the child if they go to a different school. Okay. So sometimes permanent exclusions happen because something so bad has happened, no kind of systems and things can be put in place. So the child will go into a school that is called a pupil referral unit or alternative education centre, and they will stay there for a period of time to hopefully work with them in terms of their mental health, if that's required, in terms of kind of their social kind of experiences, their views of themselves, their subjects. Lots of different people will be involved. Whole team, and they get quite kind of one-to-one teaching in a lot of cases. Okay, and parents and carers will be involved in that process quite heavily as well. That will happen for a period of time, for as long as they can, for as long as it needs to happen. Okay, basically they need a place in a local school to become available so that they can go to the new school and start afresh. Well, that's the plan. So that's what happens. Because I remember being a teacher and having done my PGCE and everything and being in school and being in a school where someone was excluded, and I never really understood where they went, where did they go, what happened to them. Yeah.
I was going to say, I've experienced Thrive in school. Is that kind of the thing before that happened? They sort of go to Thrive and they have the one-to-one, yeah, so that it makes them to be excluded.
Well, it is something that mainstream schools do work with, but also that Thrive approach does happen in the pupil referral units or alternative education centres as well. And that Thrive approach is a holistic approach. Okay, it's looking at the child. And it's great that you're seeing it in mainstream schools. So yeah, brilliant. So I just talked through that. They remain in these placements until a new school or education provider is identified. Sometimes children can remain in these schools for years, and they may actually leave these schools when they leave education, which is not, none of the alternative education providers want that to happen, but sometimes that does happen. So numbers, I want to talk to you briefly about numbers. Because why does any of this matter? Who really cares that children are excluded? They haven't conformed, so let's just get them out of the mainstream schools and let's get everyone else learning effectively. Is that what we should be thinking? I don't know, some people are shaking. I had some people looking at me saying, I'm not sure. So I've got the statistics for kind of 2014, 2015, the 2016, 2017 haven't been published yet. But permanent exclusions in the UK, 5,800, okay? 5,800. And you would expect, naturally, less of those come from primary schools. Okay, but I have met a four-year-old in an alternative education centre. Okay, so, you know, a very complex case around that particular child, but it does happen, and it's really sad, really sad. But hopefully, that little child will get the help they need to reintegrate them back successfully, because it's happened early, and that's the way we need to look at it. Okay. And a number of fixed period exclusions, so they may go to a pupil referral unit for a period of time, a short period of time, they go back to their school, or they may just be sent home with work for a period of time. There you go, quite a large number. And you might think about the UK population and think about, well, it's about, what is it now, 65 million or something? And you might think that that doesn't seem like a large amount, but this is per year. Okay, these are the per year figures. So I think 5,000 children, or almost 6,000 children, are being excluded permanently, and having to find new schools for that many children is quite a big amount of children. And when I look at that number, I don't look at that number and think, oh, we've got loads of places to... I look at that number and I see children, and I think, that's really sad, because those children will have lost their social groups. They will have lost their friends, they'll have lost the people around them. They'll have lost their identity. Whether it was great there or not, they've lost that. They haven't got the chance to go back. And I think that's pretty sad. So, I know that you've been talking about pedagogy of the oppressed. Have you? A little bit? Maybe? No one wants to admit to it? Okay, this isn't the test, don't worry. My kind of theoretical framework for my research really adheres with Paragraph's kind of thinking around banking education. Okay, so I've put some of the quotes from my writing up there. So for example, banking education suggests that children are expected to conform to a specific structure and set of rules in learning, and they actively discourage the children from challenging the teacher. For example, teacher talks, you listen. Okay, I don't really like that. Banking education, in terms of Ferrer, seeks to serve the oppressors. Okay, and what that means effectively, in my writing, is that people who come from certain backgrounds tend to end up being the ones that succeed in our education system currently, and that they end up being the ones that are able to transform things. Children that are excluded often become marginalised, don't do so well in education, and don't get the positions of power, authority, and positions where they can make change. And that's my problem. I've got a lot of problems, but that's one of them. Okay? And that's how this kind of ties in with my thinking behind education. So I stand in front of you lot saying, go and be a teacher, and it's all amazing and it's lovely. But my real kind of the core thinking is it's not working. Something's not working, and I don't like it. But I wouldn't stand up and say that to you in just any lecture. Okay, today's a special lecture. Okay, so I'm not going to talk a lot about my methodology. I'm just going to say to you that I have used ethnography, and lots of you have touched on this in your dissertations. And the reason I have used ethnography for this research is because I'm working with some of the most vulnerable children it's possible to work with. I feel I'm in a very privileged position that two alternative education centres allow me to be around these children. These children allow me to be around them. Okay? I am so privileged to be able to do that. Ethnography was the only way I felt I could really respect them and kind of, you know, really get a true picture of what's going on. I'm not going to talk about that too much more, but I take a participatory role. I observe, but I get involved, because or else I'd probably be told in no uncertain terms to go away. Okay. Now, my pilot study findings, and I'm wrapping up now, just in case. Behaviour issues still occur in learning outside experiences that do not fall into the category of lying, so learning in the natural environment. So effectively, I am finding that learning in the natural environment is a lot more effective. Children's communication with adults and peers improves in line activities. There's a lot more kindness, there's a lot more dialogue in general. It's really great to see. Interactions between teachers and children were found to be more positive. So this isn't just about the children, it's about how the teachers are interacting with the children, which is really interesting, because I'm seeing a change in the teachers as well, which kind of removes those barriers for the children. And you'll see what I'm going to talk about in a moment. Increased dialogue between the teacher and the child, which is very important. We only get to find out about people if we actually are able to talk to them. Yeah, and that's how rapport builds, those relationships that are so important. So what does this mean? What do I think this means? So preliminary findings confirm that student-teacher interactions are more positive when learning outside. That's no massive like claim, okay? But that is one of my claims. I believe the harsh boundaries of teacher and student are softened, and I believe that the human in both participants seems to emerge. So there's something different. It's not teacher and it's not student, it's something different. Through dialogue, the roles of teacher and student, so the teacher cease to exist, and a new term emerges, teacher-student with student-teachers. Now, what I mean by that is roles are blurred. Okay, the student can teach the teacher something, and the teacher can teach the student something. And that links back to Ferrer's kind of idea around, or philosophy about education as well. Transformation of the education system and pedagogy is required rather than a transformation of the child. I feel all too often in education we are saying, this child needs to change their behaviour, this child needs to change the way that they are doing this. Well, okay, but why don't we start with the way we're doing things and build from that? So my future research focus for my 80,000 words, which I enjoy writing, is the interaction between the teacher and the pupil. Okay, really interested in that. And I could write a lot about pupil-pupil interactions as well, but I'm going to focus on this, really. Within my writing, I am going to address this particular groups thing, because sadly, children from certain groups, although I hate grouping them, are disproportionately represented in alternative education centres and pupil referral units. And I think this is a problem, a major problem. So males are there a lot more commonly than females. And as a mum of two boys, that's a problem for me, personally, as well as professionally. Children from low socioeconomic status backgrounds, as someone from a working class background, that's also a problem for me. Children with special educational needs are more commonly found in pupil referral units. And again, we're failing, aren't we? Why are they there? So there are other groups that are disproportionately represented as well. And I will be kind of exploring all of this in my research and finding out, okay, why? Why is this okay? Why is this being allowed to happen? So my original question, does one size fit all? In my view, absolutely not. Questions? Just before we go to the questions, can I show you? Thank you. And I've got lots of references for you to have a look at there, which I drew from my PhD research. Okay. Oh, should we do? Yeah, questions?
The last quote you put up about children who are more like represented in the like those places, about SEN children, I was going to ask. So, are those children, from your experience or from what you've read, coming from mainstream schools more, or are they coming from SEN schools? And If they are coming from SEN schools, do you know like why you think that's happening? Are they not being provided for enough in those original education settings?
That's a brilliant question, but largely my findings currently are showing that they're coming from mainstream schools and perhaps issues haven't been identified and support systems haven't been put in place.
Okay. Just a quick question about children that aren't necessarily in society. I grew up in a village school where we had a gypsy camp just down the road, and these gypsies would come in and come out quite often. Has your research touched at all on how groups that aren't even classed as sort of low socioeconomic, just sort of that aren't linked to government?
Well, I've actually if you're thinking about vulnerable groups, travellers are actually sort of included within those groups. So you won't always know what supposed groups children belong to, okay? I've talked to children who are travellers and I've known about it, I've been made aware of it, and what was the original question? Sorry, have I?
How can you involve children that are sort of outside of society?
How can you involve children in right sense of society?
Well, that's a massive question and a massive problem, isn't it? Because I think what I'm doing here is talking about children that are being excluded from our mini societies, our mainstream mini societies. So I believe that children who are being excluded and going to people referral units are being marginalised. Okay. So I don't know is the answer. I don't know, but I'm willing to work on how to find out. Yeah.
We have some questions coming in on Twitter. Edward asks, if one size doesn't fit all in education, why do we still have a standardised national curriculum?
I mean, it's difficult, isn't it? Because there has to be, there's two sides to every story, isn't there? Something's not working, okay? But I understand why we have this standardised approach. It's to ensure that there's almost quality assurance across the board. And like you were saying earlier, it's to try and stop people not having a good education. So understand why we have it. That's a difficult question. The question is perhaps the system we have in place at the moment just isn't working as well as it could for some children. Whether that would always happen, no matter what system we had in place, I don't know. Yeah.
Just come to you, Charlotte, so we can hear you on the web.
Freya argues that dialogue is a tool for freedom, and you spoke about how dialogue between teachers and students can reduce disaffection. So would you promote Mercer and Wegerif's exploratory talk in education as a form of dialogue to break down the barriers? Especially the idea that they need to, both teacher and student, need to identify with the discussion itself.
I'm familiar with Mercer's work, Masters before focused purely on dialogue, okay? And although dialogue is an aspect of my PhD, it isn't the entire of my PhD, if you like. So it is an aspect of this, but there's more to it. So at the moment, I'm not just looking at dialogue, I'm looking at kind of non-verbal forms of communication. I'm looking at things like Skinner's work on demonstrating that there's behavioural engagement. There's so much to it at the moment. It's massive, but yeah, I probably will touch on some of Mercer's work when analysing some of this. Yeah, but great. Yeah.
To sort of carry on from that, what do you prioritise more in an effective sort of learning environment? The student mental relationship being built up to develop positive rapport, and then the learning that occurs as a subset of that. Whether you think the learning should come first, and then behind that you have all the emotional and social side?
With the groups of children that I work with, it wouldn't be possible to do any learning at all unless they had some sort of positive rapport, okay? They would just be out of the classroom. So, out of the outdoor classroom, if you like. So, I think for me, my experience with the children that I'd be working with is that rapport, that kind of mutual respect, at the very least, is required for a positive learning environment to occur and known to occur full stop.
Why is that being brought in at a base level within primary education if it is shown that it's being an effective method to teach? You know, if you have a positive relationship with your students and you become a student mentor, as you said there, why is that not the basis of our education compared to we're going to wait for the problem to happen, we're going to remove you from the situation, and then we're going to try and solve that problem and put you back in the curve?
Maybe because I haven't published yet. But I'm hoping my work will be used for future policy, because I'm not messing about with this. I really think that this is, this sounds a bit dramatic, but I am devoting my life to this now. And to devote your life to something that is all-consuming, it means that you must really believe, okay? So lots of things are going to come out of this, and hopefully I would like government to listen to what I'm saying. But I've got a course coming up on that soon, how to promote your work in Parliament, so we'll see how that goes.
I was fascinated to see your statements about things like the environment there. So my question, I suppose, is around the configuration of classrooms. What do you think we could be doing to change the way classrooms are laid out and designed that would include more children in learning?
I think that's a massive question, but I'll talk from personal experience in terms of what I felt has worked. I feel that lots of primary schools have a carpet space, they have an outdoor space to go to, not all of them, and then they have little pods of kind of tables where group work can occur. And it's quite an informal environment. I took that kind of model, and I even had the kind of space on the floor, the space to have movement, so PE students, you'll quite like me saying that, to secondary school. And I worked with a number of very challenging children. And that kind of freer, more informal, more kind of collegiate, more kind of encouraging group talk, group work, environment worked very well, very, very well. Okay. So that's what I would promote. But I'd also promote taking them outside.
I'll give someone the final question, the killer question, you know the one I'm talking about. Who wants to ask the killer question at the end? I think you on the end here, you can ask the final question. The killer question about the assignment.
Who should write the curriculum?
Not me. It's a difficult one, isn't it? But I think the curriculum needs to serve the needs of the children. And I think a team of professionals need to work together. Real teachers, really working with real children to develop that, and it should come from the children upwards.
Okay, one more question and then we have to finish. I'll rush over so we can hear you.
I think the issue isn't with the curriculum in the case you're making, it's more the tools using to teach and represent the curriculum. If you develop these relationships and you go outside and you use all these different tools, then you can teach photosynthesis, but you're just teaching it in a different way.
And you have 100% got that correct. Yeah, I believe that you can teach the national curriculum to any child as long as you teach it in the right way. But we've got to do some more work on that.
And with that bombshell, we'll close this session. So thank you to Kelly. Thank you very much, Kelly. Excellent food for thought there, some ideas perhaps for your assignment, maybe a theory or two that was thrown in for good measure. Take a few minutes break, a couple of minutes break, while we change around for our next speaker. Good.
Kelly, when writing a paper in September because I'm presenting at ERA. My paper got accepted for the British Education.
We're all back in the room again. So, had a few minutes to think about the last session. That will link to this one in a very big way, as you'll see later on. You might not see all the connections at the moment between all the lectures. You might not see all the connections between the seminars either, but it will all come together, believe me. Just be having a conversation with some at the back who are saying they feel everything is not linked at the moment. It will connect. So, I'd like you to welcome our next guest speaker, Miles Whitney.
Right, welcome. Start off with a quote. What I'm trying to do today is to give you a slightly different perspective on the curriculum. If you look at your assignment question, it talks about a global perspective. So I'm going to give you a global perspective to start getting you to think. I'm not going to give you all the answers. I'm going to try and sort of pinpoint things. So I'm going to sort of point in the direction of things to find out a little bit more. So the first one is, I'll put a quote up by Howard Gardner. Now, I know speaking to my seminar group, but quite a few of them had heard of Howard Gardner. Quite a few of them hadn't. Can you hear me? Yeah, good. Quite a few people hadn't heard of him. If you haven't heard of him, please go and find out about him. I think one of my last slides has got another little link back to him, so I'll start with him and end with him. His theories are very current, and one of the nice things about Howard Gardner is he's still alive, so he's still writing. So he's one of the ones where you can go and find books, you can find journal articles, conference papers, and actually once you've read those and actually understand where he's coming from, then actually his blogs and things like that will show where he's thinking today. Right, so I call this the Finland question, but it's a little bit more about it. So I'm just using Finland as a sort of leaping off point. I've been going to Finland for a long time now, maybe 15 years travelling there, so I've got a fair idea of education, and some students here have been very lucky enough to actually work within the education system for a little while and have a taste of what it looks like from the insider's point of view. I'm really using this as a comparison, because I think that if we want to look at our own curriculum, how do we know how we could change it if we couldn't see something that's different? Now, people like myself have been teaching for a fair while, so I've been through several national curriculum. A lot of teachers out there remember teaching before national curriculum arrived, or have viewpoints. So, but for you, you've actually been brought up through the national curriculum. You weren't taught in schools probably before it existed. I know what it could have looked like without it. And actually, if you've experienced it and understand how it works and what the differences are, then you have a much stronger viewpoint whether you believe in it or not. Okay, so that is a finished classroom. Probably taken about 3-4 years ago, but it's still pretty typical of a finished classroom. I think the first impression I had walking in there was, this looks a little bit like the classroom when I was at school, because they had little foldy-up desks. They haven't got my ones, because they're a little bit older. They used to have a little hole in the end for putting your ink. But actually, by the time I got to school, we didn't use ink in that respect, so you didn't use an old-fashioned fountain pen or probably a quill. It moved on a little bit, but that's not a lot different from when I started at school. So I think, from my memory of school, the nearest we've got to what we see in primary school today probably was in my very first couple of years. After that, it was like that. So if I experienced something like that, I thought, this is actually quite old-fashioned. In some ways it is, and that's part of what I'm going to do today, because I'm going to talk to you about what it looks like up until last year. And unless any of the students have gone back, it's changed. And it's going to be sort of focusing on that aspect. And what I'm going to try and do today is to talk a little bit about Finland, and then talk about how they've changed their curriculum, and from a Finnish perspective, answer that question. As in, they thought about who should define the curriculum, and they came to a conclusion, they did it, and they've now put a new curriculum in place. Okay, this is for the people who've never had the opportunity to go out there. So imagine, as a teacher, there are no inspections. No such thing as Ofsted. Well, there wouldn't be something called Ofsted because that's a British thing. But you haven't got the threat of being inspected. There is actually, you are protected within Finnish law in your classroom space. It is your domain. So if someone says, I want to come in and watch your maths lesson on Monday, you are legally obliged to say no. Don't want you coming to watch me, even your head teacher. But generally, yeah, come in, fine. Because it's a professional space. So you don't get regular observations, but there might be, because you might be co-working with other teachers and that may be how you learn best, but it's voluntary. No national tests, no SATs tests. The first national test they do is at age 16. No tests like SATs, no league tables. So no data which tries to compare one school against another. Schools did do tests. They've been teaching certain blocks of often about 2 weeks, and they'll do a test at the end of that. But that's for the teachers. So a lot of formative testing, and the summative testing is, where have we got to now? Not to tell you how they're comparing about the school next door, or the one up in Kent, or the one up in Birmingham, but actually, where are the children today? Where can we get them to go tomorrow? Actually, sort of useful tests. I remember as a teacher, probably once, twice a week, did I sit for any length of time in the staff room. That was one day we had a lunchtime staff meeting, and one day we had a training session, which is after school. Apart from that, I may visit it very briefly, and usually for a coffee break, the nearest I got to a coffee break was going into the staff room, filling my mug with coffee, and then exiting quickly. And quite often in the staff room wouldn't be very many people at all. Most of my breaks were spent in my classroom or on playground duty. and that's where I spent most of my time. So actually you become quite isolated. Go into a finished staff room, and it's packed at break. Now, when I started teaching my school, I had a morning break and an afternoon break. By the time I left, the afternoon break had been sort of stopped for Key Stage 2. So it's really, for Key Stage 2 teachers, just a morning break and lunchtime. So one break a day, or two breaks if you include lunchtime. Finished teachers, they teach for 45 minutes, then have a 15-minute break. 45-minute teaching, another 15-minute break. Or it could be, depending when lunch is, that second one might be a half an hour break. And they're all in there. And if it's a 15-minute break, when the bell goes at the end of 15-minute break, they don't all rush up. They stroll back to their classrooms. They're not in a rush because actually there's less for them to do. And they're very confident in what they're doing. So breaks, we actually get a chance to talk to people. And if you get a chance to talk to people, you can share ideas. So it actually helps with your learning, helps with your teaching. I don't know if you can remember way back, so I don't think Rob does it anymore into lectures now, but when you were in year one and you had a school experience lecture with Rob Bennett, he might have talked to you about the fact that it isn't like Waterloo Road. That you're not going to walk in with the children in the morning and then as they're leaving, walk home with them. In Finland, that could happen. It could be that as the children are arriving on the playground, so is the teacher. They could be arriving 5 minutes before the lesson. Generally, they're in a little bit earlier than that, but not massively. I think most of the schools I've worked with, teachers are often in an hour, two. Actually, a couple of schools I do know in Torbay, the average teacher is in about 7:30, 7:45 in the morning. And they leave maybe 6, sometimes 7 or even 8. Some of the schools I've worked with in Finland, I've worked with 4 now and the year's been there. When the students have been doing placements, formalised placements, they've been kicked out about 4:30, 5 o'clock because the automated alarm system comes on. They can't have anyone in the building because no one works in the building at night. You go home. And what do you go home to if you're a finished teacher? Paperwork, marking, no. Evenings and weekends are family time. That's your time to be spending with your children, that's your time to be spending with your wife, your husband, your partners, your friends. So there is an expectation you'll be taking huge amounts of work home. So it's a completely different culture. I don't know if you can see this. The PowerPoint is up in a PDF form on Moodle, so you can have a look at these sort of later. But these are a few quotes I picked out about the Finnish education system. It comes up a lot. I'm waiting to see the manifestos because quite often at least one political party will mention Finland somewhere in their education section of their manifesto. Possibly not at the moment because there's been a little bit of movement, but it's still seen as quite a leading education system. On the PDF version, if you click on the picture, it'll take you to a YouTube clip which explains what PISA tests are about. They happen every few years. If I wait down, I have that one, it's a little later. They happen about every 3-4 years, and they have a different focus. So the last one was focusing on science. The previous one was focusing on mathematics. But they do look at what we would call the core subjects of English, maths, and science. They sometimes do additional tests where they're looking around certain things, so they've been doing a focus on well-being. This will give you like a little introduction. It's about 12 minutes, worth watching to actually find out about the tests. It's quite persuasive, because I thought I really don't believe in these tests. But I looked and thought, actually, yeah, I can see where you're coming from. The organisation which one to, which is OECD, the Organisation for Economic and Cooperative Development, this starts getting into the philosophy bits, which is about how do you judge success. Generally, you should be judging success in this country, through a capitalist country, on money. So if you've got lots of money, fame, you're doing really well in your life. But if you judge your success on maybe the value you give back to society, which may not be a month ago, may be different. It is about economics, and their idea with PISA is to say, we'll look at people who have gone through an education system, they do the test, I think, at 15, which is sort of like the earliest
that some people leave formalised education, and we look at how they do in English, well, it's not English, but it's their native mother tongue, mathematics and science. And it's not just like answer papers, it's about thought and how you utilise that and comprehension. And we'll see how well their education system sets them up for adult life. And the idea from it is that you can work out which systems are, which countries are doing what, and what are they doing right, and hopefully that can inform your own practice. Now, for a long time, Finland has sat at the top of Europe, so that's why we've looked at it as being a really good system. That's probably a bit small at the back, but the top arrow is pointing at Finland, and the second, the next arrow down, is pointing at the UK. In the world ranking, we're actually okay. Clearly, we'd like to be near the top, and we're sort of a bit top third, but not near the top. And Finland's a lot higher. The highest one, if you can't read that, you've got Shanghai, China, Singapore, Hong Kong, and Chinese Taipei, and then Korea. Hello?
Do you mind if I ask a question?
Yes, of course.
I know Hong Kong's sort of an autonomous region within China, but Shanghai's a city, so are they comparing the cities compared to a country?
They are, I think, talk about different education systems, so my understanding would be that each of those places would have a different education system and see how it values. I think with Hong Kong, you've got the historic bit that it was under British rule for a long time, so there's a lot of influence. We're still probably going through that transition stage of like the population going through that. So some of them are a little bit more focused. Most of them are country-based. If you look at, going back to some of the white papers, there was a push for the Conservative government towards Finland, and that's gone a bit quieter. They're now often looking at the Far East and looking at the techniques there. I'm always a bit suspicious about politics, because I get this feeling, I may be right or may be wrong, that what they do is they think about how they would like to do it and then try and find a good example to try and sell it, to justify it. A bit like your year one assignments, where you wrote down what you thought and then you went to find a reference which supports your viewpoints. And I think politics works.
Hi, Jane.
Right, the first, that one there was 2012. And they give it a total score. The aggregate score for Finland was 512, the UK was 494. This is the most recent one, which is 2015. On the PDF, there's a link which will take you to the actual data page, so you can look at the research paper, you can look at all the evidence there. At this point, Finland is at 531 against 519, so they got better. And the UK is at 509 against 494. So both countries have actually improved their ranking. This is a book being published quite recently, that's in 2016, Miller and McKenna, which is talking about, in a similar way to the PISA test, they're talking about literacy, not in a pure sort of mother tongue way, who can read and write, but being literate is being able to communicate effectively, particularly in the world of work. And their research, which is independent of PISA, came up with this ranking. And again, we've got here Finland at the top, being one of the most literate countries. And I've added us on there because we weren't in the top 10, so the UK comes through at 17. Notice I'm actually using the term UK. And if you're talking about the national curriculum, you are talking about the English national curriculum, unless you state otherwise. That would be our assumption. The PISA tests combine the countries of the UK. And there's a little bit more about that when I get to the end, and sort of separate some of that out. What I've got here is, this is a white paper from 2010. I'll get a quick scan of that. So this is, we're talking about, historically, we had a Labour government which started with what they call education cubes will be education, education, education. Massive changes with Labour government in power for a long time. That ended with the Conservative Liberal Democrat coalition. This is around about when this was published. And at that point, I think if you go back to some of the Labour white papers, Finland's mentioned in one of them 39 times. It was still really important at this point, but they were starting to look more towards the Far East. So it's mentioned 5 times in this one. And then, oh, we're going to get the next one up. Oh yeah, this is going back a little bit. Rose Review, which is 2009. So this was right at the end of the Labour government when they proposed a new curriculum. So they commissioned Rose to review primary education and help form the direction it was going to go in. You probably, in some of the schools you were taught in, may be aware of what was happening. There was a big change. Schools were training ready to launch it, and then the government changed and it got scrapped. At that point, so going back a year, it was mentioned 9 times. This is 2016, so we're much more up to date. Education excellence everywhere. So this is really pushing. This is, well, I guess the current Conservative government, this is where they saw themselves going, but now potentially throwing a spanner in the works by having an election. But at this point, when this was launched, there was the assumption they were going to do a 5-year term. Interesting, Finland is mentioned no times whatsoever. So Finland's sort of off the table of being part of the UK policy. Let's go back to 2014 with the national curriculum, and it is name checked to that point. So the current national curriculum does have Finland name checked, but you can see they're not just looking at one particular country. They're going to cherry pick. They're going to pick the elements they like. Some of those I feel a little bit uncomfortable. Some of the Far East countries, yes, they achieve really high results, but the children start school at 8 o'clock in the morning, similar to Finland. But they work till 6, and then they go to evening school in the evening, maybe from till about 8 o'clock. I don't know that my brain would cope with that. That's a level of education, but it works. Whether it'll work here or not, it's another one thing you could look at. So a few bits more, I'll give you a bit more detail about Finland. So, bits to consider about the Finnish system, what's sort of different about it, and maybe this is why it works. Children don't start school until they're age 7. 98% of children do attend preschool, which they'll call kindergarten. So most children will attend the kindergarten before they go into formal education. But compulsory education doesn't start until 7. If anyone's interested in Steiner education and looks at some of their research behind Steiner, there's quite a lot of argument there where they're saying that children's brains aren't developed until age 7. That's when they become really receptive for learning. School starts at 8, so I mentioned that. The first classes, and they tend to, the younger children, the earlier they go home. So we have got a standard end of school day. But the first classes might go home about 12 o'clock. Again, the cultural difference is the Finnish child will get to school and take themselves home with no parents there. So it's quite unusual seeing the parents in the playground. Their interaction tends to be with the school via email. And the children would be trusted to go home with their own house key. And the assumption would be they would do their homework by the time that the family are home from work. So once the parents are back, then it's family time, because we've done all our homework. Whether that actually happens in practice, children are children. Some will, some won't, but that's the assumption. All children, and this is sort of moving in our country, all children have a free school dinner. Everyone gets a cooked school dinner every day. That's primary and secondary equivalent. So all through education, If at university, one is education at university is also free, so there are no tuition fees, it is free, all the way up. So if you're doing a master's or a PhD, it's all free. And their food is subsidised, so they don't get free dinner, but the government puts some money in there to keep the prices down. No school uniforms. Teachers, not called by their surname, because in Finland, the teachers are respected as being professional. They don't need to have you calling them Mrs. So-and-so, Mr. So-and-so, or Sir. They're called by their first name, or they actually use the word Ope, which is teacher. So it might be saying teacher, or their first name. Children arrive, as I said, without parents, and depart without parents. You often don't see the parents. Car sizes are actually growing, because again, there are economic issues in Finland, so they are starting to grow a bit, but a typical car size was about 24, 25 in the last few years. And I mentioned that the lesson pattern is about 45 minutes with a 15-minute break. When they get that break, there is an expectation that everyone goes out. And generally, all the children come prepared for the weather. I remember going to Finland one February with my daughter when she was, I think she was about 12 at the time, and we're in the staff room looking out the window at the children playing, and they have one of those little thermostat things which shows you the inside and the outside temperature. And it was minus 36 outside, and about 24, 25 inside. But the children were wearing those like all-in-one suits and stuff, playing in the snow. But they're all out there. It's raining, they're out there. There's no like, oh, it's wet place day. That doesn't happen. I think the head teacher of one of the schools said it hit minus 45 one year, and they kept them in for one of the breaks. Generally, no sets, no streaming. Actually, differentiation is, you can't spot it immediately, because generally the children are all doing the same activity. They differentiate with the amount of support the teacher will give them, but it's not obvious. You haven't got the teachers setting like five different tasks for different ability groups. Everyone gets the same thing. No, well, there is a national curriculum, but it's not quite the same as ours. So I'm going to go into what it looks like now, but their national curriculum is set by the government. It's defined locally. Teachers are in charge of their class. They are professionals, they are trusted. And unlike here, they're trusted by everyone. They're trusted by other teachers, they're trusted by the head teacher, they're trusted by the government, they're trusted by the parents, and they're trusted by the media. They don't have to justify themselves all the time, because people see a teacher like we might see a doctor and a lawyer. It's a well-respected profession nationally. Very hard to get into, I'm going to go into that a little bit later. And all teachers are educated to master's level. Got a couple of quotes here. I would challenge the inclusive bit, because I don't know that Finland's got it as well as we have. Because the special needs children tend to be put out into special rooms. And I've been to some of the schools where you would do very well coping with the behaviour management, they just couldn't, when you put like an autistic child into the classroom who wasn't having a good day, the teacher would just look at them and didn't know what to do. So it's meant to be inclusive, but I'm not sure they're quite there yet from the evidence I've seen. This is sort of supporting what I've been talking about. If you do want to investigate a little bit about Finland, this one's called Finnish Lessons 2.0. Finnish Lessons 1.0. We probably haven't got the 1.0. But Finnish Lessons there in the library, loads of copies and ebook copies. There's another book I'm going to refer to in a moment. At the end, I've been communicating with Julie Lux at the beginning. She's trying to get hold of one of the books at the moment. But there's another one coming out in ebook within the next few days. It's been ordered, So it's usually about 24-48 hours before it's available, but I'll tell you that one. And this is the guy who wrote the book. So looking at why their system works. Okay, we know that their PISA scores are good, and we know they're better than us. What can we learn from them? And this is down to people's research. It's not necessarily the answer, but this is what people think it might be. Rigorous selection process. So looking at here, teacher training. Don't know if you remember when you applied for your post on the course. I'm being involved directly with that part of recruitment for a little while, but I think you probably read an article and then you discussed that. The average finished candidate applying will be provided with 250 pages of articles to read before they apply. They would then be challenged on that for an entry test and an interview. The entry test would look at their comprehension and their thoughts about those 250 pages. The focus of the interview is actually trying to work out if this person is suitable. So it's your personality is suitable for teaching. So we've done all the tests to work out if you've got the academic ability. Now we're actually going to interview you to see if you're the sort of person we want in the school. Out of all the people who apply, only 10% ever get in. And it's quite usual, if you go into the equivalent of here in Finland, that most of the people are in their early 20s in the first year, because a lot of them would have applied 2 or 3 years running, and each time go and get some more experience. And they would have worked in school for a year, so similar to our PGCEs. So a lot of the people when they start have been working in schools for maybe 2-3 years before they get their entry into the university. And I mentioned it's a master's programme, so they do 5 years. After the third year, they basically finish their undergraduate, their bachelor's, and they move into the master's phase for 2 years. Right. Again, why is it good? The teacher is their domain. They're autonomous in their classrooms. Lighter workloads, maybe giving the teachers less to do means that actually they've got more time for the creative side, to creating some good lessons. I'm working with some stuff on social work at the moment, and some of the research there was looking at child deaths, and some of the, there'll be famous cases you've heard of, but each time there's been a child death, they put more and more paperwork for social workers to do. And they're now to the point where the equivalent of a social worker will be working 4 days a week on a computer doing paperwork and get half a day actually seeing children. And it has made no positive impact into the number of child deaths. So getting the social workers to work all those hours doing paperwork hasn't seen any improvement whatsoever. Maybe the same is true with teaching. We're getting you to do more and more paperwork, but actually, are things getting better? They're less accountable. They're not being inspected. People aren't sort of judging their teaching on a daily basis. They are judged, because they're judged on how well the children do, but not against national standards. And interestingly, I think in this country, the average teaching career is now 5 years. In Finland, it's a lot higher. Retention is really, really high. So it's actually quite hard to get into the profession. And once you're there, so I've been going back to one of the schools now for a good 15 years, and virtually all the teachers who were there, apart from ones who retired, are still there. I don't know if many UK schools, if you went back to them 15 years later, you'd even see one person the same. No teacher evaluation system, such as Ofsted. They trust teachers to do their best. The way teachers are judged, they also do appraisals, but everyone does that anyway, so that's the way you have a conversation. I said they're seen as not being invited. This is just to illustrate what a sort of typical Finnish timetable will be like. 45-minute lessons, shorter school day, the younger the group, the shorter the school day. So teachers actually do teach less hours per week. So the children actually have less time in school anyway, because they start at 7. They've got lots of breaks, and their actual teaching day is a lot shorter. I mentioned about 15-minute breaks. And the teachers actually do take a break. Very little standardised testing, so this isn't a grade-driven country. And also the range of lessons is much broader. And because of that, there's actually, they value a lot of the subjects, so you'll see the schools are very well equipped. If you're a music specialist and you walk into a music room and finish school, you'll go green. Typical music room in a primary school will have a huge range of instruments, including probably a couple of full drum kits, electric guitars, amps, mics, so that when they're actually doing singing, they can record it and burn it onto CDs. So actually they're really fully equipped woodworking, metalworking, electronics, all sorts of things. Well-resourced schools, they really do, like we do, go for STEM subjects, but they also go for life subjects, because it's just as important in Finland that you are a citizen and you understand how the world works as a human being as to working out the academic side. This is a book I'm trying to get hold of for you. It's written by an American who has been teaching in elementary level in America, has moved to Helsinki, and went, wow, why don't we teach like this in America? So he's written a book about it. And what he's tried to do is to write the book from the perspective of an American elementary teacher about, okay, you can't change the world, but there are things you can do. So it's sort of 33 tips about how someone can realistically adapt their practice to be a bit more Finnish and hopefully improve education. Now, in the book, he really points out that he feels that the reason why it works is there's a value of music. Music's really important in Finland. The breaks are really important, both for the children and for the teachers, so people are fresh in the lessons. And actually, good lessons are 45 minutes, and the teaching time in lessons is probably about 30 minutes. It's really focused. There's no sort of waiting around. It's really sharp and focused. Lots of fresh air. Maybe that's the answer. The fact that children go outside 15 minutes in every hour and get fresh air, maybe that's the answer. Peaceful learning environment. Now, this is one to talk to those who've been out there, because it does vary. Again, like English classes, some are quiet, some are noisy, but he generally found that Finnish classes typically are a lot quieter. The children don't tend to work in groups, they tend to work independently, and tend to work at a much quieter level. So less partner talking. He really felt that the teacher training itself could well be the answer, and that's the book I'm going to give you at the end is focusing academically on that, analysing that, because the teaching and training is so good and broad that there's a real sense of expertise, and there's a confidence. The teachers actually have confidence in their abilities because people aren't challenging them so much. Teacher-centred learning. What is a bit surprising is it's textbook-driven. So you've got this teacher who spent 5 years, possibly 8 years trying to get into it, 3 years to get in, 5 years working through to their master's dissertation, so they're actually really, really good at research level at that point, and then their maths lessons are all taught from a book. And some of the books, I have seen English translations because they use them in the international schools, they're really prescriptive. So, today's lesson, write this on the board. Now ask the children this. This is the answer you're looking for. Now get them to turn to page 52 in their exercise books and get them to do this exercise. Here are the answers. Now, the people who've been out spinning with me would have met Vesa Marti. Now, he's doing his PhD. He's a maths lecturer. His PhD is about the quality of textbooks and whether actually textbook-driven education is better than the creative side with someone creating their own lessons. So he's examining that. And actually, I think the argument out in Finland is the textbooks are really, really high quality. So they're reliable. And maybe because the teachers are so expert in their subjects, they can make a proper judgment about the quality of those books. What does he mean? Do teachers work during the day? They work at night, they take work, less work home, if at all. And because they've got those regular breaks and time, they connect with other teachers. Maybe that's the answer. They have time to talk and share. And maybe that happens with things like behaviour management. So you haven't got to worry about it all day and you've got no one to talk to. You're sat having a cup of coffee and say, I'm having a bit of problems with so-and-so. Oh, have you tried? Maybe that's the answer. And I've done quite a lot of work myself on mental health training, and one of the things they say to survive the world and survive life is the ability to switch off. And because the teachers don't take work home, they have weekends, they disconnect from work. So mentally, they're better off. I've mentioned those two books. This is one of the interesting things now, because people have looked at Finland and seen it as a leading world education system, they're now starting to export their education elsewhere. And those who've met SMRC may actually realise that the first two there are ones he's directly connected to. So what other systems are other countries looking at is, can we adapt your model? That's one of the schools we've worked with. This is Katarenta School in Rovaniemi. And I put that up as a question is, yeah, okay. Loads of ideas about why the Finnish education system works. Could we directly import it here? Now going back to that 33 tips book, his thing was, no, you can't export it to the US, but there's certain things you could do. And possibly that's my feeling. Because it's a cultural thing. They don't have the Daily Mail in Finland, so they haven't got media condemning teachers. There's a feeling of professional. That will take years to build up, that, so people are respected and feel professional. The culture of the children. Well, I did mention Daily Mail, so I can remember when I was at school, the Daily Mail ran headlines about latchkey kids, about how awful it was that working parents gave their children of school age a key so they could let them into their houses at home and be home alone while they're still working. That's Finnish culture, because children are trusted. So maybe we haven't got the trust for anyone in this country. Teachers aren't trusted, children aren't trusted. Maybe if people aren't trusted, then they go and do the things. We're gonna get in trouble anyway. A little bit about Finnish culture. Obviously, Moomin's the top of the Finnish culture. You have to like Moomin's to live there. World Happiness Report, and if you look at the PDF, there's a link to that. The happiest country in the world is Denmark, then Switzerland. Finland comes in at number 5, and the UK comes in at number 23. Interestingly, the bottom is a country which I haven't heard of, called Burundi, in East Africa. Second up from the bottom, which doesn't surprise me, is Syria. Because probably Syria isn't the best place to be at the moment. So they're bottom, they're near the bottom of their happiness scale. So we're quite well down on that. What they judge them on is income, but the report does say there isn't a correlation between having more money and being happier. But generally, you need a certain level of income to feel that I don't have to worry about it, so that makes me happy. The work conditions. So do I actually mind going to work each day? Am I treated with respect? Health, population health, and that might be to do with actually general health, mental health, but also health services. Levels of pollution, social values, social equality, maternity and paternity leave. Low crime and free healthcare. One thing about Finland, though, and this is one of the arguments why you can't export the education here, same with the US. Our country, maybe not Devon and Cornwall, but our country is very multicultural. Finland is hardly multicultural at all. And there is, you'll see a lot of the stuff at the moment, and this is coming through the political debates at the moment. I know this is one of the arguments for Labour, is child poverty is increased massively in the last 20 years. I think it's now 30% of children are in poverty. In Finland, it's virtually zero. It's very equal. So you haven't got this disparity between rich and poor. Maybe that's the answer. Maybe what we've actually got to do is tackle child poverty, and that might help. This guy here, Finbay, is actually questioning, is it all over? Because Finland started dropping, their results weren't rising as well as they should be against the PISA scores, and actually the Finnish government panicked a little bit. So they have made some changes. What I've got here, next few slides, is talking about actually answering your question from a Finnish perspective. Because they've asked the same question. Our system is good, but it's not as good as it could be. We want to improve it. So then they asked that question, who should define the curriculum? And they actually came up with some solutions, put them into action, and now they've created a new curriculum. Their answer to the question, which doesn't mean it's your answer, was educational providers, which is the people who work in schools mainly, but it's not just schools, it could be any educational establishment, so teachers, the head teachers, the TAs, anyone who provides education for young people. Educational personnel, so that's quite a blanket one, covers anyone who works within education, parents, and pupils. So they were all consulted to develop a new curriculum. It was launched in 2016, it was being piloted in 2015, and this is how it works. Their government controls education like ours does through Education Acts. They control the budget, they decide on which subjects must be taught, they can actually decide on how long, so what percentage of the curriculum needs to be in which subject, and they can also determine the length of the day in each grade. They then pass the actual creation of the curriculum to what's called the National Board of Education, which is made up generally of academics from educational faculties of education from universities. Probably a bit of a high percentage coming from Helsinki. So they actually create a national core curriculum, which is quite a lot, but it is a skeleton. The educational providers, and in the city where we do the work up in Finland, which is Rob and Amy, there is actually Olli, who's the head teacher at the school which we work with, is the chair of the local educational provider, the council. They work with lots of head teachers, lots of schools, and they create a localised curriculum. And then the actual teacher ultimately defines what is taught. So the curriculum has a really basic outline. The local curriculum is then developed, and the local curriculum, if we're talking the equivalent here, is we'd probably have a Plymouth curriculum, we'd have a Torbay curriculum. Devon will probably be broken into maybe 8 different curricula. So they're quite small. So it's not localised as in a whole county or a local authority, it's much smaller groups. Maybe an academy chain would be an equivalent. So this is looking ahead, things that they like and they've kept going. So there's still no national testing, still no inspections. There's a lot of, they call interaction between levels of administration, which means teachers talk to educational providers, the educational providers talk to the national board, and the national board talks to government, and actually in between. So teachers talk to government, and again, they've got one teaching union. So the teaching union itself acts as the voice of the teachers. So there's a lot more discussion going on. And ultimately, they're looking for the very best learning. And I think they're saying through the level of training teachers have, they understand what good pedagogy looks like. These are the areas they want to push. They realise that globalisation wasn't something covered so much in Finland, so that's going to be a big push. IT, actually Finland was quite embarrassed. They are a leading manufacturer, they were the biggest mobile phone exporting country in the world with Nokia at one point. But technology-wise, they're really dynamic with technology, but it wasn't there in schools. They're embarrassed looking at other schools and thinking other countries thinking we haven't kept up, and sustainability. But it's also important to be, where are we in the world? What's our role? Looking after ourselves and community fields. And their feeling was, at the current curriculum, so that's the 2000 and going back, pre-2016, that generally students in school are happy, but not as happy as they would like them to be. And a happy student learns better. Let's get that love of learning back in. Let's work out actually what our education is for. What do we want? What's it there? What's it for? What's the philosophy behind it? Look at the children as an individual. And let's look at how that learning environment works. Well, it talks about 7 transferable competencies. Thinking and learning to learn. I think I've got that one wrong. Taking care of oneself, cultural literacy, multi-literacy, and by that it's the literacy we would understand, which is more about the mother tongue literacy. Cultural literacy is actually about understanding about other cultures, ICT, the world of work, and sustainability. Well, this goes back, as I said at the beginning, you mentioned Howard Gardner. While the curriculum has been developed, quite a few people say, looking at the new Finnish curriculum, it looks like almost a direct correlation with your theory of multiple intelligences. And actually, if you look on some of his blogs, he's gone, yeah, you're right. There is a massive connection. They've looked at how children learn and realised that actually it's not just about English and maths, about the mother tongue and mathematics and science. It's actually a whole range of subjects. I'll put this one up because I started with talking about global perspective. Some of you will go down the finish line, particularly maybe some of the students who've been there. Others will look at other cultures and use that as a stepping off point. If you want to use one quite close to home, with the PISA scores, they use the UK, but actually PISA does break it down. And out of the 4 countries of the UK, England does top and Wales is bottom. So sorry, the Welsh, but your curriculum sucks. Saying that, what they did, the Welsh, because they now have power of their own education system, is they went to the OECD and said, help. And the OECD have been working with the Welsh government to create a new curriculum. That was created before the last PISA tests, and in the last PISA tests, out of the 4 countries in the UK, the top is still England and the bottom is still Wales. But what they did say was, it's not going to work in a year. It's going to take 10 years of an education system before you can even look at it to work out if it's a success or not. Now, putting into that mix, think about the role of politics. If you look at historically, there's only been a few periods where we've actually had political stability. Happened with Margaret Thatcher, happened with Tony Blair. That's when a party stayed in power for more than one term. A lot of the time it bounces back between Labour and Conservative. In those sort of years, by the time they thought about what they want to do, they're not in power anymore. So only can we start judging education on those long terms, see what actually happened and was it making a difference. They're my references. So as I said, this is up on Moodle. And Steve, if anyone's got questions, you're going to be the roving mic.
Thanks, Miles. Would you like to show me your appreciation? So there's a global perspective for you. There are some questions coming in. Has anyone got a question that you want to ask me for? Well, Jacob asked the question earlier on, didn't you, about on Twitter, about the statement of curricula being defined by, well, set by the government and defined locally. Did you want to follow up that question?
Is there a difference between defining a curriculum and setting the curriculum? If there is, what is it?
That would be part of your argument if you were writing about that. In my terms, I'd say defining a curriculum would be maybe about the philosophy, about what its purpose is, what you want it to do, and maybe roughly how it looks. To the setting, and that's the bit I'm concerned about. I like the freedom with curriculum, and I feel that setting is very much defining it down to the micro level, so going from macro to micro. I feel that setting is about saying this is what we do. Now, as a teacher, I've been through that with the literacy and numeracy strategies, particularly numeracy strategy, where you'd look at term one, week one, Monday, I've got to teach this. Now, maybe they do that in Finland because they've got textbooks. But I didn't like that restriction. I called that setting, telling me what I'm going to teach, how I'm going to teach it, when, rather than maybe this is what we'd like to achieve.
Any other questions? I've got another one on Twitter here from Lauren. Well, let's try and paraphrase this. What can the UK government learn from some things about teacher well-being and teacher retention in Finland?
Good question. I think you can't expect to get the best out of someone, and this actually goes back to a little bit like Kelly was saying, the pastoral side, that actually if we treat people well, the results from them, I think putting pressure and expecting people to have amazing results under massive amounts of paperwork and stress is going to achieve what we want to achieve. Maybe if you can pull that away. It's happening in social work. I had something called the Munro Review, which is basically cutting a lot of that away. Again, it's going to take a long time before we see that, but their aim is to pull that away and make social workers feel more professional, give them more time to actually focus on their day-to-day work and actually the bread and butter, which is working with children or adults in need. I think that's what we need to do with teachers. We need to pile away all the paperwork, give them more respect, see them as professionals, free them up with time. I know from a mental health side, if you can take time out, it's better. If you're working all hours, your functionality isn't there. You need to take a break, rest your brain, and then you'll work more efficiently. And I think we need to give teachers that choice too.
One of the biggest differences I found in the Finnish classroom, comparing it to here, was that in the Finnish classroom, there was an expectation for the teacher to make a child learn. If a child was sitting there and didn't want to open the textbook, or they were talking, or they just weren't in the zone to learn, it wasn't their perspective was that it wasn't the teacher's responsibility to make that child learn. It was the child's responsibility to learn. And if, for example, Ofsted walked in, that wouldn't be a bad reflection on the teacher that the child didn't want to learn, because they view it as the teacher being a tool for the child to use to learn, but it's ultimately all down to the child's responsibility to learn. And I thought that was a really huge difference than what we have over here.
And maybe not having Ofsted, who one of their observation requirements is that actually everyone's learning in the time that they are observing you, takes the pressure off. Coupled on to that, one of the things I experienced in Finland was doing a focus observation on a lesson where they taught it in Finnish. So I had no idea what they're teaching. I knew they were doing IT stuff because there were computers involved and robots. But beyond that, I had no idea what they were saying. But what I was able to do is focus on other aspects. So I was focusing on their classroom and their behaviour management, and watched there's a girl who sat about two rows in front of me, and the teacher was talking, giving various instructions, and she opened up the desk. So as soon as that desk lid goes up, she's blocked from the teacher. So he can't see her, she can't see the teacher. Rummaging there, she had a baseball cap on, rummage, closed the desk, sit there for a bit, get up, walked over, sharpened a pencil, went back to a table, got up, went to the toilet, came back, now, if that was you and we were doing a focus observation in you, I think your grade would be quite low. Well, why did you interact with that child? Why weren't you ensuring they're engaging in their learning? What we found by talking to the teacher is that person had learnt everything. Because when it came to the crux of the lesson where they had to do their bit, she knew exactly what she was doing. Because she was wandering around, but she was listening, she was engaged, just didn't look it. But that was fine. And there was a trust. And I think it goes back again, maybe Charlotte, with that, is the trust of the teachers, but the teachers trusting the children. So actually, if you don't want to learn, that's your choice. But actually, I'm going to trust you that you are going to learn.
So we'll finish with We'll finish with one more question. That wasn't intentional. From me, I guess, because I actually spent some time with Patsy Sundberg, you've been on the screen a couple of times, in Korea last year. And Korea, actually, at the time, as now, is above Finland in the PISA tables. And we had a long discussion about PISA and its merits, and I suppose failures in some way. What's your personal opinion of PISA as an accurate reflection of the standard of education across a whole country?
I think looking at PISA, on my first things with PISA, I was quite against it. When you find out a bit more that it's not just a test, it's about how to apply it, so I had a bit more faith in it. But my worry about PISA is it's very much going back to Howard Gardner about certain intelligences. It's looking really at mathematical and literacy levels, particularly, and science, which is fine if that's what you value. If you feel that that's the most important things in society, but I don't. So I can value someone who is very creative, who's an artist, who's a musician. I think they're just as good as someone who can sort of read and write well. It's about communication. So I think they distract because I think they it's a narrow focus.
See what you would say in your assignments if you bring PISA into this. Make sure you get the facts right about what PISA actually measures, and that it's 15 years old when it actually happens. That's when the test occurs. So lots of food for thought there. Once again, things that you might want to include in your assignment, you might not want to, depends on the focus. But once again, finally, thank you to Miles. If you can hand in your registration form, whoever's got it, if you haven't signed it, then please come to the front. Okay, much appreciated. And see you next time.